close the door and come.
सहनावतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सहवीर्यंकरवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै। ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः। गुरुर्ब्रह्मा गुरुर्विष्णुः गुरुर्देवो महेश्वरः गुरुरेव परं ब्रह्म तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः। When they say thank God it is Friday, it is not for God that they are saying thanks. So we have seen the first Anuvaka. First Anuvaka is rather lengthy Anuvaka. It has about 15 mantras, starting from नमस्ते रुद्रमन्यवौतो तैषवे नमः अप अंटिल अथो य इषुधिस्तवारे अस्मन्निधे हितम्। टिल देयर वी हैव सीन द वेरियस एस्पेक्ट्स ऑफ द स्पिरिचुअल जर्नी और द ग्रोथ ऑफ द इंडिविजुअल सीकर। एज दैट इंडिविजुअल सीकर ग्रोज फ्रॉम बीइंग स्केर्ड ऑफ द लॉर्ड, understands that there is nothing to fear. If there is anything to be feared, it is not the Lord, but something within us, which is called our own Jivatma Bhava and the Ahankara. These are the two things that we have to be really scared of. These two which creep from the avidya, which gets strengthened through our kama, karma and vasana. So the seeker realizes that and says that, Lord, that raised bow of yours with the arrow aimed, use it to destroy these things which become a stumbling block in my sadhana, in my growth, so that I can progress step by step towards you. Now that Lord which is being worshipped, this is another beautiful meditative shloka, or not meditative shloka, meditative mantra. And this meditative mantra, there are a lot of arguments, because it does not come under the main Taittiriya Samhita. So when you read the original Taittiriya Samhita, we do not come across this particular mantra. Neither does it find reflected in the shorter version in the Rig Veda, nor in the other part, the Shukla Yajur Veda. You don't find this particular mantra. But for ages, this particular mantra after first anuvaka has been practiced for sure, because various orthodox commentators, when they don't comment on it, they do mention that there is one particular mantra which is not a part of the Veda, therefore they are not commenting on it. But it is a very beautiful meditative mantra nonetheless. So we will look into it. One of the commentators who does comment on it, or not comment, but at least mention the entire mantra, is Abhinava Shankara. So this particular mantra, most of us, or all of us, at least here in our Dallas Chinmaya Mission, know it by heart. Or at least we have memorized it. Hopefully it will turn to become by our heart, that it becomes really embedded in our heart. So, do you want to repeat it, or let us stand together, because everybody knows this. Om Namaste Astu Bhagavan Vishveshwaraya Mahadevaya Trambakaya Tripurantakaya Trikalagnikalaya Kalagni Rudraya Neelakanthaya Mrityunjayaya Sarveshwaraya Sadashivaya Shriman Mahadevaya Namaha. But when you are in the Rudra chanting, it doesn't go this slow. It is usually at a faster pace, and the first time I learnt this particular mantra, I was told that this, and there is another one in the last anuvaka, if these two mantras you can chant with single breath, that means you have learnt Vedic chanting. That is how I was taught. So I used to make sure that I used to run through it. It's only when I understood the great purposefulness and meaning in behind it, I could not but go slow, because each word has got that beautiful meaning in it. So this is neither the first anuvaka nor the second anuvaka, an insertion in between the first and second, which you don't find in the Yajurveda, neither the Krishna Yajurveda nor the Shukla Yajurveda. Namaste Astu Bhagavan Vishveshwaraya Mahadevaya Trayambakaya Tripurantakaya Trikalagnikalaya or Trikagnikalaya. Both are versions. Kalagni Rudraya Neelakanthaya Mrityunjayaya Sarveshwaraya Sadashivaya Shriman Mahadevaya Namaha. Now this beautiful mantra starts with Namaha. In fact, if you observe, it starts with Namaha and ends with Namaha. Namaha Te Astu, and then Mahadevaya Namaha. Namaha Te Astu, may our salutations be unto you. May we offer our salutations unto you. You who, it is said, Hey Bhagavan, Bhagavan, O Lord. Should we go over that exercise again? Aishwaryasya Samagrasya Okay, together we stand as one family. Because it started. Yeah. We stand really good as a family. The first portion, second portion, third portion, the last portion I'll complete. Shanna Bhagayati Rita. four quarters and four people have said it. So the one who has these six qualities is called Bhagavan, and we have seen it twice so far. So hey Bhagavan, what Bhagavan or which kind of Bhagavan are we talking? Vishveshwaraya. Now I'll go through the word meaning and then go through the depth of it. Vishveshwaraya, the Lord of the universe. Mahadevaya. Mahadeva, among the devas, you are the greatest. Lord of the lords. Trembakaya. This is one particular part of the mantra which sometimes is not pronounced properly. We pronounce it as Trayambakaya. It is not Trayambakaya, it is Trayambakaya. Tra is half, followed by ya, it becomes Tria. Trayambakaya. Trayambakaya, the one who has three eyes. Tripurantakaya, the one who burnt or destroyed the three cities called Tripura. Trikalagnikalaya, the one who is the very basis of the three periods of time, which is like fire. Time is often considered like fire. Why, we will see it. Kalagni Rudraya, he is not bound by time, and he is also considered as the destroyer of time. Kalagni Rudraya. Neelakanthaya. Neelakanthaya, a very specific detail of only Lord Shiva. The rest of it can be interpreted to other forms of gods as well, but this is one specific detail of Bhagavan Shiva. So if you are worshipping Ganesha, one specific detail which nobody else has. Lambodara, Vakratunda, Ekadanta, Shurpakarna. So these are specific details of only Lord Ganesha. Similarly, one specific detail of only Lord Shiva is Neelakantha, Neelagriva. Mrityunjaya, Mrityunjaya, the one who has won over Mrityu. In fact, Mrityu functions on his directions. And the one who has won over the death by protecting Markandeya. Sarveshwaraya, Sarveshwaraya, the one who is Lord of everything. Sarvasya Ishvara, the Lord of everything. Sadashivaya, Sadashivaya, Shiva auspicious. Sadashiva, the one who is ever auspicious. There is never a time, never a moment, never a phase wherein there is Ashivatva. He is ever auspicious. Shriman Mahadevaya, endowed with Shri, endowed with all kinds of resources. Mahadeva, it seems to be like there is a repetition. Now here also there are commentators who argue that, you know, this is not a repetition, it is the same word, you know, which is in a conclusion being repeated again. But there are some who say that here when Mahadeva it is said, it is not the Lord or the greatest among all gods, but it is from the standpoint of that Satchidananda Paramatma, that he is the ever effulgent, ever illuminous. Mahadeva, Te Namaha. Namaha Te. This Namaste that we usually say in our Vedic heritage, in our Sanatana Dharma, which has become our Hindu culture. The first thing is that we need to bring both hands together. It is not a single-handed, or you know, like the fellow Americans would say, that first it was how are you doing, now how are you doing became howdy, other versions of it, what is happening, are you okay. So from that it became WhatsApp. Now WhatsApp became sup. Now nowadays they don't even say those things. The only thing that, hey, it's too much of effort. That's it. The first time I came from India, and within like 7-8 months I started going to the SMU for the Yuva Kendra class, and I used to drive down and it was in the students recreation center, and the room that they had given, which was a multi-purpose chapel or a prayer room, multi-purpose prayer room. So we used to gather there, and it was right next to the gym in the students recreation center, and there were these tall African Americans. I myself am 6 foot and I have to look at them like this. They're 3 times wider than me. I used to be scared just coming from India. So I had a tough time. So this one African American would, you know, he'll be looking at me. I would very scarily look at him and then bend my head and go into the room and said, chalo, today's class, I'm safe inside now. Somehow there was some guarantee that he would not step inside. So I used to feel unthreatened. So after a couple of weeks of going there, this fellow used to say this. I must have done something really wrong to tick this fellow off. Because coming from India, if you know, in an unknown area, if you are not belonging to that area and somebody says this, it means, you know, what are you doing here? It's not meant, you are not meant to be here, kind of. So I came back. My advisors and guides in those days were the 12th grade students. They have a ball with me even now when they come, because they repeat all these things which I had to clarify from them. So I asked them, you know, this African American, he looks at me and he does this. What does it mean? Oh, Swamiji, it is nothing. He is just saying hi. I said, Vaji, ajeeb tarika hai hi kehne ka. It's almost like, you know, threatening. So how should I respond? Very simple, Swamiji, you also do this. Now it has become an easy thing that, you know, earlier it was a different head shake. I said, no, Swamiji, it has to be this way. So there was a 5-minute rehearsal with him, and then next week when I went there, he did this, I also did this. That's all I was told. And then as soon as I did this, he smiled and he said, what's up, dog? And then, I must have definitely, this kid must have, you know, put me in soup. I must have really ticked this fellow off that he called me a kutta. What wrong did I do to this fellow to call me a dog? So I rushed back that Sunday, I caught this kid and I said, did you put me in a mess? Did you? Said, what happened, Swamiji? I said, this African American, when I said, responded, he said, what's up, dog? He said, dog means a friend. I said, which language? So the spelling of this dog is D-A-W-G. Dog. So what's up, dog means friend. So, wow. The different kinds of. But the true namaskara is when you bring both hands together and then bend your head down and say namaste. The beauty of this particular act, it is such an act that it is immersed in beauty and purposefulness. This very act, because the focus is on the act and unto the one to whom it is being offered, and nowhere the individual who is offering it is shown importance. The one who is offering it is insignificant. The act is important, and unto whom it is being offered is very important. Te, unto you, namaha, namaskara. See, when you say namaskara, what does it mean? नमः आकार, नमः मीनिंग वेयर देयर इज नो माइंड, मन आकार इज अहंकार. वेयर देयर इज नो माइंड और द अहंकार, दैट एक्ट ऑफ ईगोलेस सेल्फलेस प्रेजेंटिंग योर सेल्फ एट समबडी इन ऑफरिंग योर सैल्यूटेशंस, that act is called namaha, namaste. So the very act itself is a spiritual significance. What is the entire spiritual significance? Not to be somebody, to be a nobody. Since it is very difficult to be a nobody everywhere, at least start with the presence of the Lord. At least in front of the Lord, be a nobody. Because when you are a zero, that is when you can offer to that infinity your salutations. Any amount of self-value or worth in it, there is always an equation. I am doing this because there is a hidden agenda. And the act itself says that there is no hidden agenda. There is in fact no ego involved. It is just being offered an offering, that's all. नमः ते, ते हु ऐश्वर्यस्य समग्रस्य, द वन हु हैज गॉट द सिक्स क्वालिटीज ऑफ भग, सच वन इज कॉल्ड भगवान, एंड टू सच भगवान वी आर ऑफरिंग अवर सैल्यूटेशंस. द वन हु हैज कॉम्प्रिहेंसिवली एवरीथिंग, एंड टू सच भगवान. What is the meditation? What kind of meditation do I have in my heart when I think of this Lord? Vishveshwaraya. It starts from Vishveshwara. See the amazing beauty, if you look at it, there are 11 names of the Lord, with two Mahadevas considered as two different names. One is Sriman Mahadeva and the other one is Kevala Mahadeva. So 11 names. And these 11 names start with the first one, with Vishveshwara. Now whether it is this sequence of names or the names from the Vishnu Sahasranama, where you find that the first name of the Lord also starts with not Vishnu, it starts with Vishnu. It starts with Vishvam. Vishvam Vishnur Vashatkaro Bhuta Bhavya Bhavat Prabhu. It starts with that Vishvam. Now here the beauty is, he is not just the Vishvam, but he is also the Ishvara of the Vishva. Vishvasya Ishvaraha Yaha Saha. The one who is the absolute boss of the entire cosmos, the entire creation. It is not just the creation wherein only Indians and Hindus are. Every aspect of this creation, he is the ultimate Niyanta. Niyanta, the controller. Ishvara means controller. Vishvasya Ishvara. The beauty in Sanskrit is, if you know how to decipher the words, the same word can yield lots of different meanings. So one meaning is Vishvasya Ishvaraha. The second meaning is Vishvam cha Ishvaram cha. The one who is expressing as the Vishva, and yet he is also the boss of this Vishva which is expressed. Therefore, every aspect of the Hindu mindset is to see, perceive and act with that act of respect towards everything in this universe. Sometimes when I go to college, it is really difficult, because these kids sit in the chair and as their footrest, they put their feet on the bag. So, first time I was really very not comfortable in that environment. So, I made a request. Listen, the culture that I come from, we respect everything with this attitude of worship worthiness. And education is considered as the most sacred act. So, it is considered as divine. So, as long as we are in the class, would you not put your feet on the books or on the bag? So, one kid said, now that you say it this way, we are cool. I didn't understand, we are cool meaning he is going to continue put his feet there or we are cool not putting our feet there. So finally, they understood what I said and they put the bags aside and put their feet down. So, whether it is paper, like I was in somebody's, I was visiting and they had come to pick me up. So, the kid also who was there, who was sitting in the front, so he said, I'll sit back, Swamiji, you sit in the front. So, he sitting took a while. He was fiddling with something. So, we turned around and that car must have been just taken to the cleanup. And when you give it to the cleaning, they put a paper underneath. So, that kid was picking that paper up and folding it because it was drilled into that kid that you shall not place your feet on any paper. So, he had picked that entire thing up, folded it nicely and then sat down. My heart was really touched. Then not just paper, anything. Whether be it a flower, whether be it a tree, whether be it a stone, everything is treated with that aspect of divinity. Because everything in this Vishwa is nothing but the Lord in different forms. And there is another beautiful indication. The beauty of this indication is, if we cannot perceive that which we already perceive as Lord, that which we are not able to perceive, will we be able to perceive that as a Lord? The core of your being, just be still. Kya samajh mein aayega khak? Go find that core. It's all abstract. Satchidananda Paramatma, Parabrahma Paramatma. Go figure what it means. When you say that the Lord is in the flower, you can see the flower. And when you can see that flower and the beauty in that flower, you can appreciate the presence of that Lord. Like we have seen in the earlier part of the mantras, that the very Pratyaksha Daiva is the Surya Bhagavan. That is why the first thing that we do early in the morning is we offer Arghya before the sunrise, welcoming the sunrise, welcoming Lord Sun. And then we offer our Surya Namaskara. When do you offer Namaskara to Bhagavan? For anybody for that matter, when they are coming in or after they have come and you know it's already in a few hours, and then when you leisurely get up and say, hey, hi. Sorry, I just got up. Sorry. So, as they are coming, with respect, you say Namaskar. So, the Pratyaksha Daiva, all these are Pratyaksha Daiva. So, he is Vishvamcha Ishwarancha. He is not just Ishwara, but he is also the very format of this entire Pratyaksha cosmos. And he is the Niyanta of this cosmos. To such Lord Shiva, we offer our salutations. Our salutations are offered to such Vishveshwara. Namaste astu Bhagavan Vishveshwaraya Mahadevaya. Now, Mahadeva, it's an apt title for Bhagavan Shiva. Nobody else is called Mahadeva. and you know, everybody is God, you know, all are gods, but among these different gods, only Lord Shiva is considered as the Lord of the Lord. Why so? Because of his vairagya and because of his readiness to reach out, irrespective of who is worshipping him, whether it is Sura or Asura, Deva or Daitya. Have you ever seen a Daitya or Asura worship Bhagavan Vishnu? Because those who are maintaining it, there is always a problem with those who are indisciplined. They are not in the good books of those who are maintaining it. So wherever there is that authoritative maintaining job, and those who are of the crooked nature, they don't go well at all. They are constant ruptures. But Bhagavan Shiva is such a approachable God that even the Daityas and Asuras worship him. Surascha, Asurascha, Daivascha, Daityascha. And he is readily available for protection. And the one reason where he gets this title for the first time as Mahadeva is when his unparalleled sacrifice wherein the entire universe would have collapsed if he had not stepped in during the Kshirasagara Mathana. During the Kshirasagara Mathana, all gods and all the Daityas had assembled there to get something from that effort. It was only Lord Shiva who went there not to get but to give. To give himself up. Now that Kalakuta Visha which was there, even the Devas were swooning and they were also collapsing. And when he saw everything, you know, in such a chaotic condition, the first thing that he did was not to find out who did this. And when something goes bad, the first thing that how did this happen? And however it happened, can you fix it? And he paused for a while, not to doubt, not to run away. Where is the escape route? No, he didn't pause for that. He paused for, because he knew what was the solution, he was pausing there to find if there was any other better solution to tackle that. Not finding one, in such an unparalleled sacrifice wherein he just swallowed it. And that is when all these gods called upon that Lord Shiva as Hum Sab To Dev Hain. Amongst all of us, you are the greatest, Mahadeva. Trayambakaya Namaste Astu Bhagavan Vishveshwaraya Mahadevaya Trayambakaya. Trayambakaya, three-eyed one. The one who has three eyes. Now, everybody has only two eyes. What is this peculiarity that he has three eyes? In the beautiful Shanti Mantra, we are indicated, Bhadram Karne Bhishrunuyama Devaha Bhadram Pashye Makshabhir Yajatraha. They are talking about the organs of perception action in plural. So we have two eyes, Akshav. But he talks about three. That the two are physical and the third one is called the Jnana Chakshu. The eye of wisdom. And some loosely translate it as the eye of intuition. That which the mothers have towards their children. They can't place their finger exactly as what is wrong, बट द मोमेंट देयर दे सी देयर किड्स एंड देयर इज कुछ तो गड़बड़ है, आई एम नॉट कंफर्टेबल. एंड द मोस्ट ऑफ देम दे वर्क ऑन दैट इंट्यूशन ओनली एंड देन दे फाइंड आउट देयर इज समथिंग दैट हैपेंड एंड आई एम ग्लैड. Glad I trusted my own intuition. And that intuition there works because it is selfless. That act of selflessness brings about the, opens up the eye of intuition. One reason why that eye of intuition, the third eye functions. The second reason is, ज्ञान वैराग्य परिपूर्णता ब्रिंग्स अबाउट द ज्ञान चक्षु. ज्ञान मीनिंग विवेक एंड वैराग्य व्हेन दे आर परिपूर्ण, व्हेन इट इज कंप्लीट. व्हेन विवेक इज कंप्लीट, वैराग्य विल बी कंप्लीट. यू कैन नॉट एनफोर्स वैराग्य टू ब्रिंग इन विवेक. And that is one of the major reasons why we have such a trouble handling our kids, because we would want to discipline them, but they don't have the viveka. Now, disciplining them is to pull them away from all that which is distracting them. Now, when we are trying to pull them away, they don't have that viveka. Therefore, 100,000 times you repeat the same thing. They're back to the square one. That is where in utter frustration the mothers and the parents scream out, how many times do I have to tell you the same thing? Are you dumb or what? Can't you get this straight? Really speaking, no. Because absence of viveka, vairagya cannot be a possibility. And when there is no vairagya, to discipline, to withdraw from those distractions becomes an impossible task. But for the one who has viveka and expresses as vairagya, when there is purna viveka, there is purna vairagya expressing in action. It is at that time jnana chakshu functions. In the yoga shastra they say, what is this jnana chakshu? Agnya chakra opens up. Agnya chakra is right here, and that agnya chakra is fully activated. How do you activate it, Swamiji? Kuch laga ke, you know, daily some mardana to be done. No, almond oil mardana. Whether you put almond oil mardan or diesel mardan, it will not have any change. It should have viveka and vairagya paripurnata. That is when that jnana chakshu will open up. Because of this viveka and vairagya, wherever there is viveka and vairagya, kama cannot enter. By mistake, if kama enters there, what happens to that? You don't need to be afraid of that thought of desire. Because the moment it erupts, it gets burnt away. These burnt ashes of the kama desire is what he wears on himself as the ashes, as the bhasma. And then we sit with our half-baked knowledge and then I have to meditate. And then what happens? Swamiji, there are so many thoughts, you know, how do I control? Start from the first step instead of jumping into the last step. Wherever there is viveka, there will be vairagya, and in the presence of the blazing vairagya, any kama vikara that takes place gets burnt away. And that is the significance of that story wherein Madana, the kama raja, comes down to distract the Lord. Madana does this 2-3 times. This was the only time that his ability to distract somebody was hailed by everybody. that you did an amazing service. Because after Dakshayani, Daksha's daughter, you know, sets herself in the Yogagni, he is lost touch with, Bhagavan Shiva has lost touch with the entire world. He is withdrawn so deep into his samadhi that there is no possibility. That is when all the devas request Kama. Now Kama said, you know, I can try it out on anybody else, not on him. So please, the entire srishti demands it from Kamadeva. Whereas Tulsidas ji puts it very beautifully, when Kamadeva goes to distract Narad ji, because Indra is scared of his seat. At that time, everybody scolds him as Nirlajja Shvana, like, you know, a shameless dog. But here is one time wherein his act of sacrifice it was. So in that act of sacrifice, he knew before he started, aaj mera number hai. My days are numbered. I am done. And then he tried his level best to distract. And the first effort that he tried, Bhagavan opened his third eye of that Viveka and Vairagya. In that blazing Vairagya, Kama became Bhasma. This is one meaning of the three-eyed one, Trembaka. The second meaning is, the Lord says in Linga Purana, he says that I have three eyes. That is why in the Shiva Sahasra Namavali, Soma Suryagni Lochanaya, the one whose eyes are Soma, Surya and Agni. Now in the Samashti's eyes are the sun, the moon and the fire. In the Vyashti, where can we see? Seeing happens only in the light of sun, only in the light of moon. Some say it is Agni, some call it as Vidyuta. Vidyuta, lightning. I transgress a little bit and I conclude that Vidyuta as this Vidyuta. That is also electricity, this is also electricity, this is controlled, that is uncontrolled, that is the only difference. So these three illumining bodies are called his very eyes. And his third eye is called the Agni, Prachanda Agni, in which all desires get completely nullified. So instead of fighting with the desires, grow and raise in wisdom to such a height and such a clarity that no desire can dare touch you. That you get distracted or confused with the clouds of our own desires born from likes and dislikes. Trambakaya Namaste Astu Bhagavan Vishveshwaraya Mahadevaya Trambakaya Tripurantakaya. The asuras were getting constantly beaten up. So, one of their leaders, Mayasura, Maya, he said, I will do great tapas. And he invoked Shivji's blessings, that please bless me to create. And he was a great architect. Mayasura was a great architect. Bless me that I create three cities, three flying cities. What we today call as sky labs. So he had created three flying cities. One was Hiranya, the second one was made of Rajata, and the third one was made of Tamra. Gold, silver, and the copper cities. And he asked the boon that as long as we, the asuras, stay in these three worlds, we should not be destroyed, we should not be killed. So, with Bhagavan's blessings, in the Hiranya Loka, or the world that he had created, there was a lake, Amrita Saras. Amrita Sarovara. Some call that as Amritsara. Amrita Sarovara. So, Amrita Sarovara was on this end and Tripura is on that end. So, they physically compare these two, but in my belief is little different. That Amrita Sarovara was in the golden city of the Mayasura. And anybody in the battle, when they would die, he would bring them, fetch them and dip them in that Amrita Saras, and they would come out alive. So, there was no way handling this asuras. So, Bhagavan, while he had said that there is one clause though, your city will be destroyed or has the vulnerability to be destroyed if they all come aligned in one line. So, Mayasura said that alignment can happen once in 1,000 years, and that too can be perceived only from earth, not from the swarga. They said, fair deal. They said, okay, accept it. Because he thought that, you know, devas would always attack from top, and from that angle, all these three cities will never be in one line, so they cannot be destroyed. But he forgot that where is the residence and office of Bhagavan Shiva? In the Kailasa, here. So, from Kailasa's perspective, it would always come in line once in 1,000 years. So, after looking at all these, so Bhagavan Shiva said, time has come for these fellows. He requested Bhagavan Vishnu to go to the Hiranyapattana, one of the cities, the golden city, and drink away all the waters of that Amrita Sarovara. So, as a cow, he enters into the Hiranyamaya city and he empties the entire Saras. So, here one of the pravaktas very beautifully points out that the cow felt safe, that it would not be killed or eaten up even in the Asura Loka. What to talk of those who eat even that cow? They must be far lower below than the asuras even. At least asuras had a moral conduct or a code that they wouldn't kill a cow. Yeah, that was a beautiful perspective presented, so I was little tickled. Now, this Mayasura is nothing but our ahankara, and our vasanas, which keep kindling these desires, you know, constantly it keeps erupting these asuratva inside. And where do they usually live? In three cities of waking, dream and deep sleep. With one bow, one arrow, when the identity to all these three cities is destroyed, that is when the jivatva is completely destroyed. And Skanda Deva, you know, Tika on Rudram, he starts with this very story. He says, that Rudra who had destroyed the Tripura, the asuras in the Tripura, he, after having in that anger destroyed the three cities, was still holding on to that next set of bow and arrow to release on whom? to such a Rudra who is in the Manyu form, angered form, we offer our prayers in the first 15 mantras of the first Anuvaka of Rudra. So here it is. The Jagrat, Swapna, Sushupti are these three cities. So needless to say, what is the golden city? Waking is the golden city. Dream is the Rajata, silver city. And the Tamra, the copper city, is the deep sleep state. The identity, when it is killed, the Mayasura is killed, the Ahankara is killed. Therefore, the Jivatva is destroyed. And then you get the opportunity to merge in the eternal source. Tripurantakaya Namaste astu Bhagavan Vishveshwaraya Mahadevaya Trayambakaya Tripurantakaya. Now there are two versions. Trikalagni Kalaya or Kalagni, Trikagni Kalaya or Trikalagni Kalaya. So whenever it is said that it is Trikalagni Kalaya, it means that the Lord, with his duty of dissolving the entire creation at the end of the creation, one of the forms that he takes is the Prachanda Agni. And with that Agni, he consumes everything into its nascent form. Wherein that Agni, which eats away even the time. And what are the time is usually calculated in? Past, present and future. All the past, present, future merges to become, come back into its unmanifest form. And the one who destroys everything, including the time, is called Trikalagni Kalaya. The second meaning or the second word used is Trikagni Kalaya. As a Grihastha, as long as we are in the Grihastha Ashrama, a Grihasthi has to follow the three Agnis. We had gone through this in the details when we were doing the Anganyasa, Karanyasa. One, there is the main Agni, Ahavana Agni. Then there is Dakshin Agni. And then there is one constant flame, which is maintained in the family. So these three Agnis are the indicators that you are constantly in touch with that divine as an Abhyasa. So the one who is the very basis of these three Agnis. Now in today's world, we don't have the Ahavana Agni and the Nitya Agni. But we have Dakshin Agni definitely, because Dakshin Agni was used to prepare the Naivedya. So in that way, we have one Agni still maintained. No, it is not your microwave. So when I ask the high schoolers, do you know how to cook? And they say, yes. I say, what do you cook? Mac and cheese. I say, that is not cooking. To mix them up in a bowl, add some water or milk and then throw it into the microwave is not called cooking. Cooking is where there is Agni. In many respects, I would consider that the glass top is also not the Agni, because you don't see the fire actually. Instead of the glass top, you see the gas top, and then you have the fire. That fire is called the Dakshin Agni, where is usually the Naivedya prepared for the Ahavana. The rest two, if you have the habit of having a Nitya, in a Nitya Puja, wherein you light a lamp, but it is not a Nitya Agni maintained, not definitely in US. Because the houses that we live are the Lakshagriha. Lakshagriha, they are so flimsy that a little spark of flame and everything is burned down. Like Lord Shiva burns Kama down, here the fire is dangerous. So even that is not. But at least if you light the lamp every day, morning and evening, in front of the Lord when you are offering your prayers and puja, so that can be called one Nityagni. Ahavana Agni is one not followed, wherein you are supposed to offer the oblations every single day. And the one unto whom it is being offered, the one who is offering and the offering itself, all of them is nothing but Brahman. That basis is Lord Shiva himself. Trikagni Kalaya, Kalagni Rudraya. Kalagni Rudraya, the one who is beyond time. That consciousness, that Agni which is beyond time. Many Hindus get confused when certain depiction or photograph wherein mother in the form of Kali. Now when mother in the form of Kali is not because she is dark in color. I found internet is a funny place, right? You can find all kinds of answers. So why is Kali black? So there are many answers. Because she is black. In fact, that is why she is called Kali, because she is Kali, Kala, dark in color. No, she is called Kali, Bhadra Kali, because she is the very form of time. So in some depictions you will find that Kali is in a very Rudra form and she is stepping onto Lord Shiva on his chest. So people are like, you know, what a sacrilege, why is this happening and why is this kind of disrespect from Bhadra Kali towards Shiva? And there are people who have given lots of significances of the disrespect. It is not an act of disrespect. It is that Kala can be controlled only by Ishvara. Nobody else can control Kala. See, when she takes that Prachanda Agni form and she goes in dissolving and destroying everything, to bring her back to balance, there is only one who can bring her back to balance. And it is Lord Shiva who can withdraw her back. None else have the capacity to control that Kala or Kala Swarupa. And here it is very clearly mentioned or to be understood that to try finding when was Lord created or who created Lord, the question of when comes into picture only if it is in the limits of time. The one who has himself created time, there is nothing to time him. So whenever it is said that Bhagavan is Kalatita, Kalatita meaning beyond time, it means that he is the one who controls the time. He is the one who has the capacity to destroy the time as well. What we do is a different case. And Bhartruhari puts it very beautifully in his Vairagya Shataka. He says, Kalo nayata vayame vayata. I think it is in the third shloka or something. I think third shloka. So he says, we think that we are passing time. Wake up, we cannot pass time. In fact, we cannot, you know, rush time, we cannot delay time. Though tomorrow we will be jumping forth 1 hour, not able to handle the time, all that we can do is jump forward, jump backwards. And many people have this concept of, you know, turning their clocks 10-15 minutes early, because I am constantly late, Swamiji. Like keeping, it shows lack of discipline. By pushing the time forward, do you think you can really push the time? Not necessarily, you cannot. So we cannot actually meddle with time. We can neither push it, we can neither hurry it. It takes on its own time. Kalona yataha, we cannot pass time. In time, we all pass. Do you have an experience traveling in Bombay local trains? So they sell, and the way they sell it also is, you have to sit there for next 40 minutes, 1 hour that you have to sit. If you are starting from VT to Virar, it's a long journey, and people, they usually do that, they commute. There are people who come from Pune, work in Bombay and leave. It's almost like 2.5 hours journey. So you should see them, they come prepared. So in their lunch boxes, while they go to the office, it's filled with food, they finish it, they clean it up, they wash it, and while coming, just before getting into the train, they gather all the vegetables and they neatly wash it in the platform and then bring it into the train. They have a small little tray and a small little knife and then and gather everything into those lunch boxes, tiered lunch boxes. There people come to sell, and the catchy word that they use is, anyway you are sitting doing nothing. So time pass mungphali, they don't call mungphali, sheng dana. You are doing nothing, time pass karo. Time pass is such a vague concept, can we really pass time? In time we all pass away, and the only one who can pass time or control it or release it is that Ishwara alone. Kalagni Rudraya. Neelakanthaya. This is another beautiful, beautiful, significant thing to meditate upon. How is he? Gauranga Sundara. Sphatika Rajata Hima Iva, like the glowing snow. If you ever have gone to the snow peak mountains, when the sun reflects on it, you cannot even see it. The glow is that glaring. That's why you have to wear those goggles that protect you from those, cut that reflection or radiation. Bhagwan is with that kind of a hue. So his entire body is white. His hair is red, a brownish red, matted hair on that white body. A light blue tinge on his neck. Can you imagine that? Such a standing out color combination. Once that image takes an imprint in our heart, it's very difficult to get rid of that image. Such a beautiful image of that Neelakantha. And on a symbolic side, when we deal with the world outside, we will have lots of ruptures, poisonous enough to keep us restless. If you allow it deep inside into your heart, you will be ruined, because it will not allow you to sleep. If you spit it out, many people who think that it is the most righteous way or the most straightforward way of living, whatever comes here, I just say it. I don't keep anything in my heart. Please put a filter. We don't need to listen everything that goes into your heart. That is not called straightforwardness. So Bhagwan shows that. Neither allow it deep inside to disturb our heart, nor allow it out in our interactions. Keep it under watch. Keep it in that balance in between. wherein it neither disturbs us nor disturbs the world around us. Neelakanthaya Mrityunjayaya Mrityunjayaya Markandeya. He knew his time was short and his parents also knew that. One day, saddened that his exit is coming near, he asks his parents if there is a way out. And the parents say that, not that we know of, but if at all there is anybody that can protect you, it is that Lord Shiva. So at that time when it is time for him to leave, Lord Yama comes down. Actually, first the Parshadas, the messengers come down to pick him up. That, we have this, what do you call that? Shuttle service. So they every day go around in the shuttle service and they have come to pick him up. And they throw the pasha, Yama pasha, to carry that jiva. Yama pasha doesn't seem to function. So they go report, Houston, we have a problem. So Yama says, how can this be? There's only one person who, is the controller of death, and that is me. How can, something cut through that? So I'll personally go and, fetch that jiva. So he goes there, and looking at Yama, he gets so threatened that he goes and does the Alingana. He just embraces that Shivalinga in front of him. So Yama, in his audacity, he throws that Yamapasha around that Markandeya and around that Shivalinga as well. And that was the only time when Lord Yama had to fear. Until then, everybody feared Yama. And this was the time when Yama had to fear someone. So Lord Shiva immediately appeared with his Trishula on his head, on Yama's head. I said, how dare you touch a devotee who is with me, that your jurisdiction is only in those places where I am not. And when a devotee is with me, dedicated totally, and this is one reason why, for good health and longevity, that we chant Mrityunjaya mantra. We will come to that. It comes into the last but one anuvaka of the Rudra section only. Trayambakam yajamahe sugandhim pushtivardhanam. Another beautiful potent mantra it is. So, because of that, Lord Shiva was again named as Mrityunjaya, the one who has won over death, the one who has crossed the death. Mrityunjayaya Sarveshwaraya, Sarveshwaraya. The one who is the Lord of everything. Lord of everything. Now, what are these everything? Sthavara Jangama. Animate, inanimate. Chara, achara. Mobile and immobile. So, you can say, where is the Lord? In my mobile. Why? Lord is in both chara as well as in achara. Your landline is achara. What you carry is mobile. Everything that has movement and everything that does not have movement. Chara, achara. Sat, asat. Sat, asat here does not mean the truth and untruth. Sat means manifest. Sat bhavati, that which has manifested. Asat, that which is an unmanifest. And if the entire creation be taken as an equation, and so our Purusha Sukta says that Pado Asya Vishwa Bhutani, that if the entire Paramatma or Parabrahma Tattva be, I mean, it cannot be measured, but if measured, one quarter of it is manifest, the rest of it is unmanifest. So if you look at the Chaitanya, it functions in the waking world, which is one quarter of our experience. The other three are in our inside, unmanifest only. Similarly, the entire cosmos, there is the Sat aspect of it and there is the Asat aspect of it, manifest aspect of it and the unmanifest aspect of it. All that included, he is the one who is the absolute controller or the lord of everything. Sarveshwaraya. So the first time I got my name after Sannyasa Diksha, so I knew what my name was because Guruji had personally said it, and so it was Sarvesha. So in the media, in when it was being published, so they made a mistake and they put Sarveshwara. So I got confused. I went to Guruji. Is my name Sarveshwara or Sarvesha? Not Sarveshwara, it is Sarvesha. I just had to mention it because I was going through it. So Sarveshwaraya Namaha. Sadashivaya. Sadashivaya, the one who is ever auspicious. There is no amangalata in Bhagavan. Amangalata can exist only in Jiva. In fact, existing as a Jiva itself is the Mahapapa. Oh, I don't do any papa. Are you existing as an individual, as a Jiva? That itself is papa. That itself is an imbalance. Any imbalance is called papa. And Paramatma is constantly in that blissful state. Sadashiva. Therefore, the entire universe, Vishwa, which is its expression, is only auspicious. Good and bad is only incidental, depending on our likes and dislikes in different situations, which are also very flimsy definition, because our own good and bad keeps changing. What is good for me today may not be good for me tomorrow. What is good for me is not good for you. What is good for you may not be good for me. Because if the entire creation is his expression, how can there be any inauspicious in this world? Sadashivaya. Shriman Mahadevaya Namaha. Finally, he is the one who is illumining, Dyotanat Devaha. Mahadeva, all the Indriyas, they illumine their field of objects. Eyes illumine the objects. Ears illumine the sounds. The nose illumines the each one for their own Vishaya Vastu. But even the eye, organs of perception, action, mind and intellect, they are illumined, hence therefore they have the borrowed quality of illumination with which they can illumine the rest of the world. And that consciousness is called Mahadeva, the greatest illuminator, because of which everything is illumined. And that illuminator alone is resourceful. Sriman Mahadevaya Namaha. Now, when this mantra is chanted, now that we understand the meaning of it, along with the meaning, each word when we start contemplating on it, as that Shivatva which is the core of our own being, as that conscious principle within. Therefore, this mantra has such a immense greatness and its validity in its place in this Rudradhyayi, wherein though it does not belong to the Veda mantra, but the rishis have accepted it to be a part of the Veda mantra. Thus, after having seen through the meditative mantra, we will go through the second anuvaka next month whenever the time is. So, for any questions as to how long will it take, I also don't know. So, his Ichha. Okay. Next time when we have Yajna, can you shoot an email to me so that I can cover it in that yajna, along with their sapatni and then various things, we can cover that. You had a question? If and when you get to that state of perceiving the Lord everywhere, that is when you are protected. That is what it means. That is when you transcend death. That is what it means. If we are limited to the knowledge that the Lord is only in the temple, only in this shape, only in this form, then we have not come into His realm. We are still in Yama's realm. When we see that the Shivatva is everywhere, that is when we are in the Lord's realm and we transcend death. That is when we are truly won over death. In the very beginning, I did mention when we are talking about the Rishi, Rishi is the mantra drashtaraha. In their deep meditations, these mantras were revealed unto them. And they in turn started giving it to their Shishya. Therefore, every mantra has got a Rishi as a drashta. That's what it means. Okay. Let us conclude it, because those who are seeing it will be confused with the questions. Om Purnamadaha Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vasishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shantihi. Harihi Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Harihi Om.